Support assistance and official respect in a positive manner. Inappropriate behavior will be grounds for removal from Bob Hanna Stadium.
Good afternoon and welcome to Bob Hanna Stadium for the CAA baseball matchup between the James Madison Dukes and the Delaware Blue Hens. I'm Tim Donnelly alongside Kyle Coulter for Hens All Access. Kyle, what do you expect out of today's game?
Well, Tim, we have a beautiful day for baseball, mid-80s, beautiful, partly cloudy, a little slight breeze brought to center field, but nothing to be concerned with. We've got a great pitching matchup today. For JMU, we got Michael Howerton. He's got a 6.18 ERA, win-loss record of 3-4. He's appeared in 11 games. And then for Delaware, we have the stud, Chad Cool, back-to-back CAA Pitcher of the Week, 3.2 ERA, 9-2 record. He's struck out 73 over the course of the season, only walked 22. He is the dominant pitcher on the staff, and we look for big things from him today.
Yeah, every time Chad Cool steps on the mound, we expect big things, and he will start today off by facing Johnny Bladell, the center fielder for the Dukes, followed by Tyler McFarland, their first baseman, and then really the premier hitter on this James Madison's team, the right fielder, Colby Roberts.
Yeah, Cool will have his hands full today. James Madison is the second best average team in the CAA, with a .316 batting average as a team. Very impressive. They're second behind Georgia State, and right behind us is Delaware. So Michael Howerton has got his hands full as well, especially with the deadly 3-4 combination we have of Jimmy Yezzo and Nick Ferdinand.
Yeah, and one thing that James Madison's going up against is a team with their backs against the wall. The Blue Hens are battling for that second seed in the CAA tournament, and to get that, not only are they going to need some help around the league, but they're also going to have to sweep the Dukes. So they're going to be throwing their ace up trying to get that first round bye in the CAA tournament.
Yeah, it's big. As we all know, they lost in the CAA finals last year. Really good team, but they didn't graduate a lot of seniors. They have a lot of returning players, including Yezzo and Ferdinand and Cool, who were really the catalyst in the team's run last year. So a first-round bye would definitely boost their confidence a lot, but they need to sweep JMU, and they also need William and Mary to lose their three remaining games.
And any sweep of a series starts with the first pitch, and that's what we will see here in just a moment as Chad Cool toes the rubber and Johnny Bladell, the center fielder for the Dukes, settles into the batter's box. Bladell digs in. And the opening pitch, called strike on the outside corner. Nice pitch from Cool to get things started.
Bladell batting .320 on the year. He has one home run, 21 RBIs. A really good leadoff hitter for this team.
As Cool misses high, 1-1.
He's got some good speed. He's got 10 stolen bases, which is second on the team. So if he gets on base, he is a threat to steal. So Cool will try to get rid of him early.
Cool being very careful. Misses low for ball number two. Two balls and one strike with nobody down here in the top of the first. Rocket shot foul, out of play down the right field line.
Good cut there from Bladell. Almost had that one, but Cool had him guessing just enough
to even the count up at two balls and two strikes with nobody down. Cool misses outside to load the count, being very careful with Bladell, the leadoff hitter. Three balls and two strikes. Cool is coming off a complete game in his last appearance, so hopefully he won't go this deep with many batters as he walks Bladell low and outside. Not a good pitch from Cool.
Very uncharacteristic with him walking batters. As I said, he's only given up now 23 walks over 95 innings pitched, so he doesn't walk a lot. That very uncharacteristic for him. But they do have to be wary now because Johnny Bladell is a threat to steal as Ty McFarland steps in to the batter's box.
McFarland, the first baseman. To introduce you to the Delaware field, we have in the outfield Tyler Powell, Cameron Travellini, and Nick Ferdinand. And then around the infield at third, we have E.J. Stoltzfus. At shortstop, we have Brock Niggerbrugge. At second base, we have the stalwart, Mr. Consistency, started every game of the last 4 years, D.J. Long. The premier hitter in this conference, Jimmy Yezzo over at first, and Ty Warrington handling things behind the plate. Cool fires. Good play behind the plate by Warrington to keep it in front of him and hold the runner at first. One ball and one strike. Cool checks the runner at first. Rocks and fires. And there's a shot to right center. Travellini on his horse will not get there. This could score one. Travellini fumbles it at the fence, and this will be First blood for the James Madison Dukes on the double from Ty McFarland. Ty McFarland, Johnny Bladell comes around all the way from first. With nobody down, James Madison has their first run.
Very uncharacteristic for Chad Cool there. That was a shot off the bat of Ty McFarland. Really got a hold of that one. Drilled it into center field. Travellini was not really able to handle it at the wall. I don't know if a play could have been made at the plate. Bladell's got some serious speed. He was around third very quickly. But very uncharacteristic start for Cool. Let's see if he can settle down here.
It is worth mentioning that the traditional center fielder has the day off today. Joe Giacchino is usually patrolling the center of the outfield. He was not there, and you don't know if he would have been able to make the play or at least not fumbled it out there at the fence.
Yeah, I don't know if anyone anyone could have made that play out in center field. Maybe if Bo Jackson was out there playing, I don't know. But definitely fumbled it on the track there. Maybe lost his footing. But regardless, the score is 1-0 JMU.
And Cool is now working on Colby Roberts, really the premier hitter of this James Madison team, as he shows bunt and lays one down. That'll be just foul. For strike number two, no balls and two strikes.
Yeah, Colby Roberts has been battling Jimmy Ezzo for tops in the CAA and batting this year. He's batting .414, very impressive, with four home runs and 34 RBIs. He is definitely the premier hitter on this team, along with the batter we'll see next, Chad Carroll. JMU, much as Delaware, they have a really good 3-4 combination here. So Cool, it's going to be tough to get through this section, but he's doing a nice job here. Count is 0-2.
Yeah, got ahead on Roberts, which is important when you face a hitter like Roberts. You have to get ahead. There he lays down the bunt. That'll advance the runner as Cool makes the play at first for one out as the runner advances to third.
Yeah, really, really well-executed bunt down there, but Cool. Cool kept calm, picked it up, fired it over to get the easy out. But now we have a runner on third, a speedy runner on third, with the big hitter, Chad Carroll, coming up to bat, batting just under .400 is Carroll. Three home runs, 52 RBIs, the most RBIs by 11 on this team.
And now Chad Carroll steps to the plate. Chad Carroll, another solid hitter for this Duke team.
Must be something about the number 8 that just spawns good hitters, I guess.
As all of you Blue Hens know, Jimmy Ezzo also rocks the 8 on his back. So Carroll trying to do his best Ezzo impression, I guess, in Bob Hanna Stadium. Big cut there from Carroll, and that'll be a strike.
Real,
one ball and two strikes.
Real nice pitch there from Cool. We can feel that breeze up here. Really nice breaking ball.
You do see how much James Madison kind of prioritizes just any runner's advancement, advancement against Cool, having their best hitter, Colby Roberts, bunt on the last play with two strikes to advance the runner. So they understand that, runs are hard to come by against Cool. They better get them while they can here in this inning.
That's kind of swallowing your pride if you're a great hitter as Colby Roberts. You see that runner on second, you want an RBI, but you know what? You do what's best for the team.
And there is a pop fly to center field. Travellini tracking under it. Runner will tag. Travellini with the throw home. It's going to be a close play. Not close enough, and that'll be the second run of the day for the James Madison Dukes as Chad Carroll gets the sac fly RBI.
Yeah, Ezzo covering there. Wasn't sure whether to pick it off, but he let it go through, and just the throw was a little offline and too much speed there for McFarland at third for Travellini to make a play. So 2-0 here with two outs in the top of the first for Cool.
The good part is you do have Cool. He's your veteran. He two runs early in a game, won't face him too much. He can still come back and have a quality start just by pitching good pitches from here on out.
And he does have a pretty powerful offense behind him that will definitely pick him up.
And now we get to see Tyler Gregory, the lefty DH for the James Madison Dukes, as he takes ball number one. One ball and no strikes with two down here in the top of the first inning.
Yeah, of the top seven hitters, Tyler Gregory has the least average, but he's still batting .273, which would be good on any other team, but he's had the least amount of at-bats. He is only has 55 at-bats, only appeared in 25 games, so he doesn't have the experience that some of the other starters do.
And he rips that one up the middle, gets just by the glove of Cool, and that'll be another hit for the Dukes as Gregory takes first.
Interesting. Watched Cool pitch a few times this season. I haven't seen a consecutive string of hits of such powerful hits in the first inning with McFarland's shot into center and then that one from Gregory right back up the middle. It's interesting. Doesn't seem like he has his best stuff today, but as you said, he is a veteran. He is the senior on this team. He will calm down.
And Warrington had the same thoughts you did. Hadn't seen this before. Went out and talked to Cool. Just wanted to settle him down a little bit, make sure they're on the same page as they settle in to face Connor Brown, the second baseman, with a runner on first. And there's a strike from Chad Cool, the pitcher for the Delaware Blue Hens. Cool is really ignoring the runner on first, knowing with two outs, if he gets the batter, this inning is over. Foul tipped back, no balls and two strikes. He's ahead in the count, 0-2.
Seems like you really don't get any relaxation here if you're Cool going through this inning. You get Tyler Gregory, but then right back up, Connor Brown is hitting 350, and then if you get to the next batter, Casey Goss, he's batting 347. So all throughout this lineup, there's power.
And there it is, called strike three on the outside. Strike him out. That'll end the first inning, but the damage is done. The James Madison Dukes come away with two runs in the top of the first to get things underway. When we return, we'll get to see how the Delaware Blue Hens answer. And welcome back to Bob Hanna Stadium for Hens All Access. I'm Tim Donnelly alongside Kyle Coulter as we get the action started back up in the bottom of the first inning. We get to see the first look at James Madison pitcher Michael Howerton.
Yeah, Howerton, not the best pitcher on the staff for JMU. He's got a 6.18 ERA, a record of 3-4. He's appeared in 11 games, 39 strikeouts, 24 walks, over 59 innings pitched. So he'll have his hands full against this powerful Delaware lineup who's going to try to back up their pitcher, Chad Cool, and put some runs on the board.
And now we get to see the local product, Delaware native DJ Long, step into the plate. He has started every single game for the Delaware Blue Hens over the last four seasons, and this is his last home series. Has to be sentimental for him as he settles in and takes strike number one.
Absolutely. He's such a solid second baseman for this Blue Hen squad. We'll be sad to see him go. He's batting 270 over this year, but hopefully he can continue this season a little longer than last year's. But as you said, played in all 50 games, 204 at-bats, batting 270, 6 home runs, 29 RBIs. He's a workhorse for this team, never takes a day off, and he's going to try to get something going here.
Here's the pitch, and that one squeaks by San Martin. The catcher, one ball and two strikes. Good eye from the senior, DJ Long. Howerton rocks and fires. And it is a hot shot from DJ Long that will get through between the shortstop and third baseman for a single to lead things off for the Delaware Blue Hens.
Nice piece of hitting. Third baseman Bradley Shabin gave it a go but could not get to it. And DJ Long with a nice piece of hitting to lead us off.
And that is what you need after you give up two runs in the top of the first. You need to kind of force the issue in the bottom of the first, and that's what DJ Long did, getting on base as the leadoff hitter. Now we will see Tyler Powell, the left fielder for these Delaware Blue Hens. Howerton checks Long at first. And the pitch. And Tyler Powell lays one down the right. No, it is a foul ball called by the home plate umpire. A little bit of a late call. But he will return and take his crack back in the batter's box.
Powell was hustling. Would have been interesting to see if he could have beaten that out, but was a foul ball. So
good piece of bunt practicing, I guess, as the outside pitch. He took it down the first baseline and was Didn't really look like he was trying to advance the hitter. It looked like he was trying to bunt for a base hit. But let's see if Coach lets him swing away here. Powell settles in. Swings away and pops one up into shallow right field. Shortstop Brown giving chase before being called off by Roberts. Roberts cannot make the play, and that will fall for an error and a advance the runners. That'll be runners on first and second base following the misplay in the outfield.
Yeah, it seems like he was kind of fighting the sun there, overran it a little bit. He was the right fielder, Colby Roberts. He was running in really quick, really fast, overran the ball a little bit, dropped in, and it was interesting. DJ Long had to hold up there at first because wasn't sure he was going to catch it, and then he had to bust it to second base. Almost got out on the force, but it is first and second for the big hitter, number one in the CAA, Jimmy Ezo.
Jimmy Ezo, just a few days ago even, was the country's leading hitter. He has fallen the second. Still no slouch in the batter's box, and we'll see what he can do as he gets a great hit down the right field line. This will score long, and Powell is booking it, and he's going to go for home, and he will score. And that is a 2-RBI double for the CAA's leading hitter, Jimmy Ezo, and they answer back. James Madison scores two in the top of the inning. Delaware scores at least two in the bottom of the inning.
And with that, Ezo furthers his CAA lead in RBIs. Now 60 RBIs on the season. 60 RBIs in 51 games, Tim. That's incredible. He is the premier batter on this team. And
I think he may have heard us comparing some of these James Madison hitters to him.
I think he did.
He did not enjoy that, and he said, watch what the best hitter in this conference does. He hits RBI doubles in the
first inning.
He
has the Hens All Access broadcast in the dugout, and he heard that. He's like, hey, I'm pretty good too.
Yeah.
And he just rips that down the right field line. Bases clearing double. And Chad Cool is probably saying, thanks, Jimmy.
Absolutely. And they've played so many games together, both juniors. They probably, said, no, appreciate it, classmate. Getting my back a little bit. And now we are back to squared up with the James Madison Dukes with two runs and the Delaware Blue Hens also with two runs. As another RBI machine, Nick Ferdinand steps into the batter's box with nobody in a runner in scoring position.
Yeah, Howardson can't relax here. Nick Ferdinand, the cleanup hitter at this team, 52 RBIs, looking to extend that here.
As Howardson misses low for ball number one, one ball and no strikes. Ferdinand getting right back in the box, hoping Howardson operates quickly. He wants to build off the momentum of the Jimmy Ezo hit, and Howardson's not going to let him do that, missing outside yet again, two balls and no strikes. And the pitch, called strike on the inside corner, two balls and one strike.
And that's the first strike I think Howardson's threw that hasn't been lined into the outfield. That was a
Or popped up to right field.
Or popped up to right field.
And there is a long fly ball to center field, and that is gone. A no-doubter from Nick Ferdinand. A two-run home run for the Delaware cleanup hitter.
Right back up 95. Did not stop to pay the tolls. Right over the fence. Right over the 400-foot sign.
Yes.
That was a bomb. And the Hens take a 4-2 lead.
And when you look at the center fielder, I think that's the telling sign of a no-doubter. As soon as it was off the bat, the center fielder just almost turned and waved it goodbye.
He turned, put his head down, and said, well done. Well done, Nick. And now I think we got a little battle going here with home runs. Yezo's got 12. Ferdinand's got 11. They're probably battling each other right now in the dugout.
I'm sure there's a little trash talk as the ground ball goes over to Brown at second, and he will get the first out for these James Madison Dukes. One down here at the bottom of the first. You have to wonder if when he goes back to the dugout if they're going to give him a little hard time for being the one guy that hasn't reached base.
Probably. Tyler Powell's going to be like, hey, I popped up to right center field. Even I got on base. What are you doing wrong?
Now we'll see what the center fielder, Cameron Travellini, see if he can continue this torrid start for the Delaware Blue Hens.
Good word.
Thank you. Here's the pitch. Showed bunt before thinking better of it and taking ball number one. Delaware has already scored four runs here in the bottom of the first, trying to add to that total with the speedy Travellini in the batter's box.
Good eye there.
Yeah, thought about taking a cut. Able to back off to take ball number two. Two balls and no strikes with one down. Here's the pitch. Travellini takes a cut at that one, fouling it back and out of play.
And you'll notice now on our Hens All Access broadcast, we now have the count in the bottom right-hand corner as well as what batters are on each bases. So that is a new addition here for this game.
Always trying to make our broadcast better for you fans at home.
Yet they still keep us on.
Yeah. So somehow we've managed to slip through the cracks, three balls and one strike. Travellini took a big cut at that one, as you just stated, to load the count, three balls and two strikes.
He was trying to outdo Ferdinand's hit there.
He said, I see your 420 and go 460 with that swing, but was not able to make contact. And that one goes into right field just down the line. It is leaking, and that will be foul. Tailed off just enough to go foul down the right field line.
Big cuts here from Travellini. It's only a matter of time until he gets a hold of one. Or he whiffs like he did on the previous two pitches.
Either way, with a full count, we're going to see what happens here. Here's the pitch from Howerton. Travellini not able to back off that one, and that will be a strikeout for Howerton. Travellini goes down swinging.
Yeah, had so much momentum built up from that big cut, was not able to hold up without going past the plate, and he goes down for the second out of the inning.
And now we will see number 24, the big lefty Chris Brannigan.
Brannigan has only played in eight games this season. He's only at bats, but he's 2-for-10 with one RBI.
And he gets the start here today, and we'll see what he can do with it as he takes ball number one. He is the designated hitter for this Blue Hens team today. So this is where he will make his contributions in the batter's box. Takes a big cut at that one. One ball and one strike. Ferdinand might have inspired these following Delaware Blue Hens hitters. They're all swinging for the fences, it seems. Misses outside. Two balls and one strike with two down here in the bottom of the first inning.
Brannigan, a senior, he's when he's not DHing, he's also a pitcher.
Yeah. One of the more versatile players on this Delaware lineup. Takes a cut at that one. That'll be strike two to even the count at two balls and two strikes.
Because some people, when they would decide they want to be a pitcher, they kind of, you know, give up on the batting. But he's like, hey, I can do both.
I'm going to be a designated hitter and a pitcher. Rare these days. Here's the pitch. Misses high to load the count. Three balls and two strikes. Howerton definitely battling with these Delaware hitters. Every at-bat very tense. Here's the pitch. And he will get Brannigan swinging to end the inning, but the damage is done yet again, doubling the James Madison output of the first inning with four runs.
Absolutely. After all four of the first four hitters come around to score, he then Howerton then strikes out and has the last batter ground out to get a 1-2-3 inning. He probably feels like he's pitched like at least three innings by now with all the pitches that Delaware made him see. But Chad Cool will trot back out to the mound and try to settle down after that first inning when we come back here on Hens All Access.
First, Cool delivers, and that'll be a called strike right down the middle for Cool. I guess San Martin wasn't looking for the fastball down the middle.
That one had some heat on it.
Yeah, a little, maybe a frustration pitch for Cool. He's had some hard times early in this game. Got a little bit of it out with that fireball.
We don't want too many of those pitches, though, because we'd like him to go deep into this game.
Mm-hmm. Following a complete game in his last outing, the runner was going on that foul ball. However, he will have to return.
Shabman, who's on first, is 2-for-2 on the year in stolen base attempts. Doesn't try to steal often, but when he does, he is generally successful. So Cool will have to keep an eye on him now. The count is 1-2.
Both teams' batters making the pitchers work, seeing a lot of pitches and putting runs on the board. So it's kind of been an offensive game so far, as six runs were scored in the first inning and a runner is on in the second. Two balls and two strikes. The count evens up with one out here in the top of the second inning.
It seems as though Cool gets ahead in the at bats, and then he keeps trying to get these swinging strikeouts, and then he keeps letting the batter get back into it. I think when he's up either 0-2 or 1-2, he's got to slam the door.
Yeah, that's always and there is a fly ball to center field. Travellini tracking straight back, makes the play, and we'll get it back into the infield to hold Chabon at first.
Nice play there by Travellini. You could see he kind of lost it, couldn't really track it, but then he got on his horse, was able to get back and make a nice play. And Cool's probably lucky that that wasn't 15 or 20 yards to the right or to the left. Otherwise, that could have been trouble because it was a really hard hit ball. But we're now back up to the top of the lineup with Johnny Bladel.
Yeah, Bladel reached in the first inning with a walk to lead things off here today. We'll see what he's able to do today again, or in the second inning against Chad Cool. Cool misses outside for ball number one. And the pitch, called strike on the outside corner, one ball and one strike. A good pitch there by Cool. Here we go with the 1-1 pitch. Misses inside for a ball, two balls and one strikes with two outs here in the top of the second.
But even though he has let a run, he has walked a runner and he's behind in this count, still a much better inning from Cool overall.
There is a foul down the right field line.
Then again, he did see the bottom of the lineup and didn't see the meat of the JMU lineup, which will be up next inning. So it'll be interesting to see how he comes
back.
Hopefully
we'll be up next inning. He's not completely out of the woods here with an even count, two balls and two strikes and two out. Let's see if he's able to slam that door, as we mentioned earlier. And that will bring the count to full, three balls and two strikes. This is a critical pitch here for Cool. If he's able to slam the door and get out of this inning and get that potent Delaware offense back on the field. There's another foul ball down the right field line as the runner goes expectedly. There
nice
is the swinging
pitch.
Strike three to get out of the inning. A scoreless second inning for the James Madison Dukes. And now we will get to see what the Delaware batters can do. We will see Brock Niggebrugge, Ty Warrington, and the top of the lineup in DJ Long when we return here at Bob Hanna Stadium. And here we are back at Bob Hanna Stadium for the bottom half of the second inning where the James Madison Dukes will trot Howerton back out to the mound after giving up four runs in the first inning.
And upcoming we have the shortstop, Brock Niggebrugge. He's one of the only three players on this team to have started and played in all 50 games this season. He's batting just over .300 at .301 with no home runs and 30 RBIs.
Here's the pitch to Niggebrugge. And that is a called strike on the inside half of the plate. No balls and one strike. It is worth mentioning that the middle of the infield for the Delaware Blue Hens is the model of consistency. We already brought up how many consecutive games DJ Long has started. And then you just mentioned how Niggebrugge is able to start every game this year. So they are comfortable with each other, and they are consistent next to each other.
Yeah, there have been a lot of been a lot of 6-4-3 and 4-6-3 double plays turned, because all three of those players have started every single game this season. Really consistent, all of them with fielding percentages above 900. So they're just, as you said, the model of consistency for the CAA and for the country to take a look at.
And here's the 1-2 pitch to Niggerbrugge. Outside, even the count up at 2 balls and 2 strikes.
And the 8-9 hitters here, Brock Niggerbrugge and Ty Warrington, really do a nice job of rounding out this lineup and getting back into DJ Long, Tyler Powell, Jimmy Ezzo. Niggerbrugge batting over 300, as I said, and then Warrington batting 257. So it's a nice round out back to the top of the lineup.
As Howerton is having a few of the same struggles Cool had, not being able to slam the door, getting ahead in the lineup, and now Niggerbrugge is able to work it to full 3 balls and 2 strikes. And he works a walk. So now we have the speed of the shortstop Niggerbrugge on first base as the catcher, Ty Warrington, comes to the plate.
Howerton does walk a lot, about just under 1 walk for every 2 innings. So I guess he's right on schedule.
Yeah, exactly. Second inning, gets a walk. Puts someone on base for the catcher, Ty Warrington. Warrington shows bunt and lays one down the first baseline. Pitcher falls down and then hits Warrington with the throw. He will be safe as he was in the base path, and that is just another way for a Blue Hen to find his way on base.
DJ Long with nice speed, great hustle, put down a really nice bunt down the first baseline. It kind of stopped dead in that grass. You can see that the pitcher, Howerton, maybe thought that it was going to roll foul, but just deadened in that grass, and then he tried to pick it up, lost his footing in the first baseline there, and couldn't get him out. So it was a good heady play by DJ Long.
And now DJ Long will step into the batter's box.
That was Ty Warrington.
As the batter for the Delaware
Blue apologies, that was Ty Warrington. DJ Long is now up at bat.
And here's the pitch. Called strike with runners on first and second. No balls and 1 strike with nobody out here in the bottom of the second inning. Here's the pitch. And DJ takes a cut at that one, fouling it straight back to even up the count at 1-1.
Yeah, he was a little mad at himself there after that swing. He kind of smacked his bat against his hand. He seemed like he wanted that one. It was right in his sweet spot. Just missed it, fouled it straight back. He's kind of licking his lips here with first and second and no outs.
Yeah, he's thinking RBIs. He wants to join the party. Delaware already has 4. He wants part of it. Takes another big cut at that one.
Caught the ump there, looks like.
Yeah, it looks like the ump is a little shaken up as both runners advance to second and third. So now we have 2 runners in scoring position for DJ Long. No balls and 2 strikes.
Well, if he did miss it, then it should be a strikeout. But they're wondering if Long got a piece of it, in which case the runners would have to retreat back to their original bases.
Yeah,
this could be an interesting call.
I think he did foul it off, because if it wasn't, then it's a pass ball and he would have taken off for
first
base.
Exactly.
And no one knows better than the batter if he hit it or not. He's the one that gets to feel it. So there was absolutely no inclination at all for DJ Long to take off first base.
And since the home plate umpire got hit in the arm, it looks like he wasn't really in a position to make a call. But it looks like they're calling it a strikeout.
And the umpire says that he did not tip it. It was just a pass ball, and both runners will advance. And now there will be runners on second and third for Tyler Powell, the left fielder for the Delaware Blue Hens. So 2 runners in scoring position. He reached last time on an error by the right fielder, Colby Roberts. And we'll see how he follows that performance up here. Takes a cut at that one, and that is a line drive to left field at the warning track, and that will be an RBI sack fly for Tyler Powell as Niggerbrugge comes home to score.
Very well done from Powell. He got it deep enough into left, maybe a little bit more. It would have been another home run, but the left fielder, Chad Carroll, had to go back right before the track and make that catch. Too far away to make a play at home, and the lead is now 5-2 with Jimmy Ezzo coming up to bat with runners in scoring position.
Ezzo with a runner on second is always dangerous. He showed what he can do in the first inning, where he lined a 2-RBI double. We'll see what he can do here in the second inning. Howerton has already given up a run here in this inning. He is hoping not to add to that total. Misses low and outside.
It's interesting because on the last at bat, that hit that he put out into right center field was the first pitch. Yeah. So I was expecting him to just swing away at that one and drive it out into that same sweet spot.
Howerton might have learned on that one to be a little bit more careful with the best hitter in the conference. And he takes a swing at that one right at the second baseman, Brown, and he will put away Yezo. But, again, more damage done for the Delaware Blue Hens. A run comes home on the sack fly by Tyler Powell.
Absolutely. It's a great job manufacturing runs. Niggerbrugger got on base. Ty Warrington bunted him over. Then they had the heads up to go on the pass ball. They didn't know if it was tipped, but you got to run anyway. Good hustle. The runner moves to third. And then Tyler Powell does a nice job putting it out into left field where Niggerbrugger can then come home to score.
Yeah, so as you mentioned, Delaware manufactures another run. When we return, Chad Cool will try to prevent the Dukes from manufacturing any kind of offense when we return. And Chad Cool gets his final warm-up pitches in as he prepares for the top of the third inning. Gave up two runs in the top of the first, but then settled down and held the Dukes scoreless in the second. He will face Ty McFarland, the first baseman, Colby Roberts, the best hitter and right fielder for the James Madison Dukes, and Chad Carroll, the left fielder.
Yeah, he is getting the meat of this JMU lineup, where the lowest hitter in this next three batters is batting .321, so he'll have his work cut out for him here.
Off-speed pitch in for a strike.
But his last batter, when he faced Johnny Bladel, he blew one past him on a full count and struck him out, so hopefully he's going to build on that momentum here.
Misses just low, one ball and one strike. Thought he might get the call on that one.
The ump stood up like he was going to call a strike, and then he's like, I'll keep this game going a little longer. Yeah.
There is a line drive right at Yezo at first base for the first out of the third inning. So Yezo getting it done on both sides of the plate. A two RBI double early in the game and a nice put out there at first base. And that will bring Yezo's competition for the batting title here in the CAA, Colby Roberts, to the plate.
Yeah, apart from all the pitchers, Yezo has the best fielding percentage. Only one error on the season. He's played in all 50 games.
You only have to hope you can witness as much of his career as you can here at Delaware before he takes his talents to the next level. Which the way he's playing is inevitable, it seems.
Absolutely. Second in the country in batting, only one error over 50 games. He's a really solid first baseman. People forget about his, because he's such a great batter, people forget about his fielding. But he's a very, very excellent first baseman.
Absolutely. As you mentioned, anyone at any position with one error on an entire season starting every game. You know, the ball will find you at some point during the season, and he has handled every situation well. As a foul ball there on the 0-2 count, keeps Roberts alive. No balls and two strikes.
And much like I liken him to Mark Teixeira over there, so smooth that he's just everything around him is like a vacuum.
Yeah. Especially at first base, you're dealing with scoops on throws to first base. You're dealing with all the ground balls at first base. He really has a lot of opportunities to, make mistakes in the field, and he hasn't taken advantage of any of them. He's just been a solid defender throughout his season this year.
Yeah, we call third the hot corner, but first we forget when lefty batters are up is almost as hot.
Yeah.
You can get, as we just saw there, speedy line shot right at him, but he handled it calmly. And Cool is working well here.
Yeah, one ball and two strikes following the line out at Yezo. Now he is working on Roberts and is ahead in the count yet again. And there is a fly ball into shallow left field. Third baseman Stoltzfus under it and makes the play in foul territory.
Stoltzfus not worried about the sun, tracked it back, made a nice catch. And Cool has gotten rid of two of the more powerful hitters on this JMU team, and he now has the cleanup hitter, Chad Carroll, to face before getting out of this inning.
Yeah, since that first inning where he got a little roughed up, he has settled down and made a lot of good pitches. We'll see if that can continue here against left fielder Chad Carroll. Carroll tries to lay down a bunt for a base hit. To no avail, strike one.
Who will win the battle of the Chads? In the first one, Chad Carroll did get the upper hand. But
Chad Carroll got the upper hand with a sac fly RBI, but Chad Cool looking to even it up there as there's a ground ball right at, as we mentioned, that hot corner. Stoltzfus just made a nice play on the fly ball in foul territory, not able to corral that ground out, and Carroll will make his way down to first base.
Stoltzfus going deep into the hole at third base. Looked like he was looking for a little higher bounce off the ball, but it scooted right under his glove, harmlessly out into left field where left fielder Tyler Powell was able to come in and grab it before any more damage was done, but runner is on first.
So although he is not able to get his 1-2-3 inning, he can still hold the Dukes scoreless in the third if he takes care of Tyler Gregory, their DH, here at the plate right now. Cool, again, waiting for Gregory to get back in that box, wasting no time out there on the mound. We've noticed that before in our Hens All Access broadcast, as a nice pitch gets Gregory swinging.
Yeah, he really likes to work fast, keep the momentum going, especially when he's pitching well like he is right now. He feels it, he gets into it, and the batters suffer for it.
And hopefully he can get off the field as quickly as possible and get those Delaware bats back out onto the field, as he does there with the strike three called. Three pitches, three strikes for Tyler Gregory,
like Cool
for Chad Cool against Tyler
like
Gregory.
Seemed like Cool and Ty Warrington were already running off the field before the the home plate umpire even made the call. He knew it.
I'm not even sure if Ty Warrington caught that. As soon as it left his hand, he was standing up and walking towards the dugout. And I guess when you got it like Chad Cool, you can make some moves like that, kind of similar to a Steph Curry, you know, jogging back on defense while the ball's in the air. When we return, we will see what the Delaware offense can do. Thanks for sticking with us at Hens All Access. And what will Nick Ferdinand do for an encore performance to his home run to dead center earlier today? He steps in the plate trying to, I don't know if you can better it, maybe trying to replicate his first at-bat here today.
Is Howerton shaking a little bit up there? He seems a little scared.
As Ferdinand digs in, I wouldn't be surprised if he is. Gets the strike one called. Nice pitch from Howerton. Here's the 0-1 pitch. And that one is blooped into shallow right, and that will fall for a hit just foul. And Ferdinand is thinking too. And he will slide in for a double. Excellent hustle from Nick Ferdinand.
Great heads-up base running there by Nick Ferdinand. He puts it 420 as we saw on his first at bat, and then he puts it just past first base, and then he makes out a double because he saw that that Colby Roberts had a long way to run, so he busted it around first base, never broke stride, and was in there with a double. Really nice job.
Yeah, so he has a two RBI home run and now a leadoff double here in the third. So Ferdinand putting together a nice day at the plate. We'll see what Stoltzfus can do with the runner in scoring position. Stoltzfus takes ball number one, one ball and no strikes with nobody out here in the bottom of the third. And there is a liner right at the second baseman. Attempts to double off Ferdinand at second base to no avail. One down with a runner on second base.
Just unfortunate for Stoltz, because he can't seem to catch a break. He's put both of his last two at-bats have gone to that second baseman. That one, a really hard hit ball. And second baseman Connor Brown was just in perfect position to catch that ball.
Howerton was able to take down Travellini on a strikeout in the first inning to kind of put a hold on the rally they had going. Travellini's going to try and get something started here in the third with a runner on second.
Yeah, Travellini with the most strikeouts on the team, so he's a very aggressive hitter, if we could put it that way, but he's got to try to settle down here with a runner in scoring position.
Howerton taking his time with the sign. Checks Ferdinand at second and fires. Ball in the dirt, a nice play by San Martin to keep it in front of him and hold the runner at second base. Travellini facing a 1-1 count against Howerton. Howerton not working nearly as quickly as we're accustomed to seeing from Chad Cool. And Travellini bloops that one into right field for a base knock.
Hey, 2-4.
Kind of a seeing eye line drive single there, just out of the reach of Brown.
It really was. It looked that ball did have eyes, just over the outstretched reach of Connor Brown. And we have first and third for the Blue Hens, who are refusing to quit at the plate.
Yeah, and again, Ferdinand being on second baseman Brown was kind of over there trying to hold him from taking a big lead, drew him just out of position enough for Travellini's single to squeak by him into right field. And now we get to see what Chris Brannigan, the designated hitter, can do from the left side of the plate. Pickoff attempt at first base.
If these runs do end up coming around to score, if you're Howerton, you got to be a little upset.
Yeah.
Both hits really just like bloop, like dink and dunk hits out into a shallow right field. So he's been pitching pitching better, but these balls, they just have eyes, it seems like, off the bats of the Delaware Blue Hens.
And now he misses outside. Ball one. Taking his time yet again. Brannigan takes a hack at that one, fouling it out of play down the third baseline. Brannigan went down on a strikeout in the first inning to end that four-run first inning, trying to make amends for that with runners on first and third. And he does with a – that'll score a run out there to left center field. Bledel gets over to make the play. And we have a play at the plate here, and that will score two as Travellini shows off the wheels a little bit and gets around all the way from first base.
Chris Brannigan, this is his ninth game played in this season. That was only his 12th at-bat of the season, and he drills one into left center field to bring his RBI total on the year to 3. Really nice piece of hitting there. And Travellini getting on his horse, getting all the way around. We thought there was going to be a play in the plate. Turned out there really wasn't. Travellini just too much speed was in there. And Delaware just refuses to quit. They're now up 7-2 as the JMU's head coach goes out to talk to his pitcher, Michael Howerton.
I think he's going to do a little bit more than talk. Looks like they're going to go to the bullpen here after Howerton gives up 7 runs through 2 1/3 innings. So
I don't think that'll help his ERA, too.
Yeah, I don't think it's going to help his ERA much. I don't think it's going to help the Dukes much. And I hope the Delaware Blue Hens can continue this against whoever they put on the mound. But they definitely had Howerton's number here today.
And we're just waiting to see the number before we can tell you who is coming in for relief for James Madison.
And whoever it is, they will face the bottom two batters of the lineup in Brock Niggebrugge and Ty Warrington.
We have number 26.
Number 12.
Mark Gunst.
Mark Gunst of the James Madison Dukes comes in. He warms up. He's a right-hander. High leg kick delivery, so definitely a different approach for the pitcher of the James Madison Dukes. Delaware will have to get used to seeing a new pitcher here in the third inning.
And Gunst, not not a much better ERA than Howerton, who he just replaced. He's played in 15 games. He's appeared in 15 games this season. He has a 6.1 ERA, and he is 1-1 on the year with two saves. So statistically, not much better than the pitcher he just replaced. But hopefully, he can do a little better. But he does inherit a runner on third in Chris Brennigan. I'm sorry, on second.
Yeah, Chris Brennigan hustled over to the second there while all the commotion was going around on the plays at the plate, which weren't really plays at the plate, as you mentioned. Just kind of attempts to get the ball in. Chris Brennigan with the heady base running to get over to second base and now have a runner in scoring position for Brock Niggebrugge, who walked in his first time up. For those of you that don't know, Chris Brannigan was the host of the Delaware Athlete Talent Show along with Nick Ferdinand, where they channeled their inner Ron Burgundy's to host a hilarious show. So has some personality on the base pass.
So he's a pitcher, he's a designated hitter, he's a good base runner, and he's hilarious.
And he's hilarious,
exactly. He's got everything.
He's a true Renaissance man out there on second base.
And that's why Delaware likes him, because Delaware loves Renaissance people.
Yeah, absolutely. Everybody loves a Renaissance man. And now Brock Niggebrugge settles into the batter's box. Works the count to two balls and no strikes against the new pitcher. And Niggebrugge gets under one to left center field. And Carroll is able to close and make the play and hold Brannigan at second base.
Deceiving. It looked hard hit off the bat, but then it just dropped harmlessly. And the left fielder, Chad Carroll, was able to come in and make the play.
And now we will see the nine-hole hitter for the Delaware Blue Hens, catcher Ty Warrington, reached and scored in the second inning. So he's trying to replicate a little bit of the success he had in his last at-bat. Brannigan takes his lead off second base. Gunst checks him out before firing a loping off-speed pitch, missing for ball number one. Missing inside, ball number two. Two balls and no strikes with two down here in the bottom of the third inning, where the Blue Hens have already scored two runs to add to their total, bringing their total up to seven runs through two and two-thirds innings. That is a low ball, got away from San Martin, and again, a heads-up base running play by Chris Brannigan advances over to third base.
Brannigan really paying attention there, sees the ball scoots away far enough for him to get over to third. He gets on his horse, gets over there, and he's now one base closer to coming home.
Yeah, now any base hit from Warrington here will score a run, as Warrington draws a four-pitch walk to put runners on the corners for the top of lineup, DJ Long.
And if you're Mark Gunst, that is not what you wanted. You wanted to get out of this inning, but now you're back up to the top of this powerful Delaware lineup with DJ Long, who's having himself a nice day.
Yeah, DJ Long went down swinging on his last at-bat. Thought he tipped it. Didn't even make an effort to run down to first. Thought he got the foul tip. Ump disagreed, and he walked to the dugout with a strikeout. Now he's going to try to avenge that whole scenario with an RBI as runners are on the corners with two out.
Seems like Gunst having a little trouble with his command right now.
Not what the Dukes want to see at all. They brought him out of the bullpen to kind of stop the bleeding, and he has let it continue a little bit here with runners on the corners. And he is missing in the dirt consistently, making San Martin work very hard behind the plate.
And a really nice job from the catcher, Bobby San Martin. He's blocked at least four or five balls in the dirt today from both pitchers, saving what has been a run in this inning.
Ooh, as Gunst finds the outside corner of the plate, not sure if that one was consistent with the calls he's been making all day. Nonetheless, it is a strike, two balls and one strike. Here's the pitch. And that one is blooped into right center field. Roberts gets under it, and that will do it for the bottom of the third inning. The Blue Hens able to tack two more runs onto their lead, extend the lead to 7-2.
Yeah, really nice job of hitting there from this entire Delaware lineup. They're not just getting it from the two, three, and four hitters. They're getting it from the whole lineup, and that's what you want to see as you're heading into CAA play. You want to see the entire lineup starting to get into it. And now Cool has settled down, and he will come back out for the top of the fourth when we come back. Don't go anywhere here on Hens All Access.
Welcome back to Hens All Access. I'm Tim Donnelly alongside Kyle Coulter as we bring to you the footage from the CAA baseball game between the James Madison Dukes and the Delaware Blue Hens. Chad Cool has settled down after giving up two runs in the top of the first inning and returns to the mound for the top of the fourth inning, where he will face Connor Brown, the second baseman for the Dukes. Here's the pitch. Big swing from Brown, strike number one.
Yeah, Brown was swinging for the fences there. Not surprising, he does have the most home runs on the team by double the amount of anyone else. He's got 8 home runs, which leads the team.
Which kind of puts in perspective how good these Delaware hitters are, as you mentioned, with Yezo with 12 and Ferdinand hitting his 11th today. So they are well above the James Madison Dukes in power hitting. And there is a ground ball to third base. Stolfoots charges and makes the play for out number one.
Such a confident play from Stolfoots, like he's been doing it the entire season. He's played in 41 games, started 29 at third, and he doesn't play every game like the rest of the infield, but he is a very solid third baseman, and he shows it right there, gobbles it up, makes a strong throw over to Yezo for the first out of the
inning. Yeah, on a chopper earlier in the game, he tried to backpedal on it, and it took a bad bounce on him. That one he learned, and as soon as it was coming his way, charged and made a nice play. Cool now faces Casey Goss, who reached on a walk earlier today.
Yeah, it's interesting. When Cool was struggling the first inning, we said it was very uncharacteristic of him, but we both kind of knew like he was going to get it back
He'll
together, and the Blue Hens offense would back him up, and that's exactly what happened.
And nice that one is there. A ground ball right at Cool, fields it calmly, makes the play for out number two. It's almost on cue. We talk about Cool settling down, and then he has a rocket ground ball right at his face, calmly makes the play and throws it over to first.
Cool's made two nice plays off the mound today. He doesn't have any errors on the season. Very strong. Not only a pitcher, but he's also a great fielder, as we saw there.
And now we will see him give his best effort to make this a 1-2-3 inning as he faces the third baseman, Bradley Shabin. Called strike one. Cool is the reigning CAA pitcher of the week, so he's definitely no slouch out there on the mound, and the two runs were nothing for Coach Sherman to worry about. There he goes, getting strike two called.
Working really quickly now, as we've noticed from customary from Cool.
And Shabin is making him wait a little bit, taking his time, taking a few practice cuts outside of the box. And Cool is not moving. And as soon as he's in the box, here is the pitch. Ground ball at second baseman DJ Long. Backhands it. Strong throw. And that will be a 1-2-3 inning for Chad Cool. All three outs coming on the ground.
Yeah, Cool. The first inning, he was getting line hit balls that have been in the air. But as you said, in that that inning. All three outs came on the ground. Very nice defensive play from himself, as well as E.J. Stoltzfus and D.J. Long at second. And the Blue Hens defense has really settled down and are really making quick work of this JMU Dukes squad. Let's see if the offense can keep it up when we come back here in the bottom of the fourth on Hens All Access.
And welcome back to Hens All Access as Mark Gunst takes the mound for the second inning for the James Madison Dukes. He will face Tyler Hall, who has already scored a run and found himself an RBI in the second inning on a sac fly.
Yeah, Gunst coming in, did give up a walk and had a little trouble with his command, but was able to get out of the inning. Let's see if he can sort of take control of himself here and try to get back on track, and try to get the Dukes team back on track defensively here in the bottom of the fourth.
You can see his go-to pitch is kind of that loping breaking ball, as you see right there, catching Tyler Powell swinging.
You know, it might work for a few batters, but I don't know if it'll work for Yezo and Ferdinand. I think they'll recognize that pretty quickly.
Yeah, a hanging curve probably isn't the best thing to throw against the power hitters of the Delaware Blue Hens, but you know, it's been working. Got him out of a couple jams last inning, and was in there for a strike this inning. There it is again, and this time Tyler Powell is able to put it in play to third base. Shabin makes the play on a strong throw from third.
A real nice play there from Shabin to third, much like Stoltzfus, almost identical to the play Stoltzfus made. And Powell, not enough speed to make it close, but here comes Yezo up for the first time to face Mark Gunst.
Yep.
And I wonder if Gunst knows what he's getting himself into with these next two batters.
This is the first time that Yezo has come to the plate today without a runner in scoring position, so he just gets to kind of unload, not worry about RBIs unless he puts one over the fence, which isn't out of his realm.
Ooh.
With that swing, he won't be putting much over the fence. Not the best swing from the best hitter in the CAA, as strike one is caught swinging.
Gunst caught him guessing there a little bit.
And now Gunst misses outside. 1-1 with one out here in the bottom of the fourth. Blue Hens have drawn blood in every single inning so far. They're going to try to continue that trend with Yezo at the plate.
This is the first inning that I believe the first inning that the first batter has been retired. I'm not sure about that, but that is big if you're the JMU Dukes.
That is a fact. In the first inning, DJ Long reached on a single before scoring a run. Second inning, Niggebrugge reached on a walk. And last inning, Nick Ferdinand hit a double before scoring as well. All leadoff hitters. So
it's probably a bit of confidence now for the Dukes getting that crucial leadoff hitter out.
It is also worth mentioning that all three of those leadoff hitters faced Howerton, and this leadoff hitter did face Mark Gunst. So it is a different pitcher, maybe a few different trends. And Yezo finds himself in an even count, 2-2. Makes contact with that one. A slow roller to Brown at second, and Brown will make the play over to first. Down goes Yezo.
And Gunst really did not allow Yezo to make any good contact with that. Mm-hmm. That grounder was off the end of the bat, kind of dribbled through the grass, and was made easy work for the JMU defense.
And now we will see Nick Ferdinand, the hot-hitting right fielder for the Blue Hens, hit a 2-run home run in the first inning and then a leadoff double in the third. Low strike called by the umpire to bring the count to 0-1 with 2 here in the bottom of the fourth. There's that big loping breaking ball from Gunst for a ball.
Just waiting for one of the Blue Hens headers to tee off on that.
Kind of just sit on it, maybe, if they could find themselves ahead in a count.
Yeah.
Big swing there from Ferdinand. Strike two.
He was trying, once again, he was trying to put it over the fence, not to no avail on that one.
Misses low and outside in the dirt for the second ball of the at-bat.
San Martin is getting a workout back there. He is sliding to the right. Yeah. He's doing like the electric slide behind the plate there. It's incredible. blocking a lot of balls.
Ferdinand takes his time in the batter's box, and here's the pitch. And that one appears to catch the end of the bat, the knob of the bat, and almost rolled for a decent bunt, I guess you could say, but it trickles foul, two balls and two strikes.
Interesting play there.
I thought it might have caught in his elbow, but I guess it did not. It caught the knob of the bat.
Ferdinand tried to sell it, tried to shake his hand a little bit, but nothing
there's
doing
there.
There's
a high chopper to third base. Chabon chasing, and it is going to be a bang-bang play, and they call him out.
Ferdinand with great hustle there. Thought he might have beaten it out, but the first base umpire did not think so. And a 1-2-3 inning.
Yeah, so Gunst comes in his first full inning of work for the Dukes, takes down Tyler Powell on a ground ball to third, Jimmy Yezzo on a ground ball to second, and then Nick Ferdinand on a ground ball to third. So both halves of that inning, all on the ground, all 1-2-3. Good work from Chad Kuhl and Mark Gunst. Hopefully the offenses will get it under control when we get back here on Hens All Access. Welcome back to Hens All Access. Tim Donnelly alongside Kyle Coulter. As we get back underway here in the top of the fifth, Chad Kuhl returns to the mound.
Kuhl made quick work of the last three Dukes batters, and he'll try to do that here again in the top of the fifth.
Now we saw Bobby San Martin make some good plays behind the plate. Now he's standing next to it in the batter's box facing Chad Kuhl. Already finds himself behind in the count. No balls and one strike. There is a foul ball straight back. Bobby San Martin now deep in the hole, no balls and two strikes.
Martin flied out to center field last at bat. He has had a rough go of it this season. 69 at bats now, is batting under 200. But like we said, he's a very solid catcher, and that's why they have him in there.
Ooh, Kuhl might have wanted that call there on the outside corner. Doesn't get it, one ball and two strikes.
But Kuhl once again working very quickly.
We bring it up every single time we announce a game with Chad Kuhl on the mound. He works extremely quickly, and there's a ground ball at Knickerbocker. Knickerbocker charges, fields, throws, and that will be out number one in the top of the fifth.
Seemed like he had a double clutch there a little bit. Didn't get a good gripping on the first one, but he fired over low. Yezzo was able to scoop it like they've been doing it the entire season, and there's one down.
Which they have been doing it the entire season. We mentioned it before. The entire infield, aside from third base, has started every single game. So they're comfortable with each other. If Knickerbocker fumbles the ball a little bit, knows that Yezzo will be there to make the stretch and get the out. Kuhl now operating very quickly. Strike one, no balls and one strike. Misses outside, one ball and one strike.
And Kuhl not getting many strikeouts, which are customary of when we're watching him pitch. But he's getting a lot of ground outs, and that's doing just as well, especially with such a solid defense behind him.
Gets the called strike there, one ball and two strikes.
Seems like the home plate umpire is being a little lenient on that outside corner today.
Not the most consistent out there.
In these last couple innings, at least. Yeah, but you'd like to see it. You'd like to see some consistency.
He's kind of growing the strike zone as the game goes on. Maybe he has somewhere to be and sees this game going a little far. The strike zone.
It's a beautiful day. What would you rather be doing than here out at Bob Hanna Stadium watching some good baseball?
Here's the pitch. Fouled back to stay alive. Two balls and two strikes.
He's got a hot day tonight.
He might. Might be enjoying this with a picnic somewhere instead of in the dirt behind a catcher. Here's the 2-2 pitch. Low and outside to bring the count to full. Three balls and two strikes with one out here in the top of the fifth.
This would be a big out because the meat of the JMU lineup is coming up next three batters. So this would be a nice out to get.
There he fights it off yet again, out of play down the right field line. Count remains full. Cool. Really, as you mentioned, a critical out. Again, fouled, out of play down the right field line. A good battle here on the full count between Cool and Bladell.
Yeah, Bladell really works counts. You see, we saw this with Torrey Conrad on the softball team. He has the most walks on the team, but he also has the second most strikeouts.
And there's another foul ball, almost identical to the last one.
He gets deep into counts, really works pitchers, him being the leadoff hitter, and then he either strikes out or walks most of it. And in the first inning, we saw that with a walk.
And the first inning, we saw with a walk. And the second inning, we saw that with a strikeout. So he's playing. And that one is a ground ball to third base. Stoltzfus fields it. Strong throw across the diamond to Yezo, and that will be out number two.
Good job staying down on it there from Stoltzfus. It was a chopper through the grass, and you never know when there's a chopper through the grass, whether it's going to like hit the lip or bounce up in odd spaces. So he got his body behind it and was able to make a nice, strong throw over to first.
And now we get to see Ty McFarland, the second baseman. Drew first blood in this game with an RBI double in the first inning and then lined out to Jimmy Yezo in the third. Cool misses inside ball number one. One ball and no strikes. Here's the pitch. Misses low. Two balls and no strikes. Cool has been able to get ahead in the count mostly in these last few innings. Finds himself a little bit behind. Two balls and no strikes. And there is a fly ball in the infield. Foul. Warrington in pursuit makes the play, and that'll be another 1-2-3 inning for Chad Cool.
Warrington decides to keep the mask on that one, which has got to be tough looking up into the sun, catching that ball. But he comes over, makes a nice catch. Chad Cool's pitcher gives him a pat on the butt, and is another 1-2-3 inning.
So Chad Cool retires his last seven batters faced. We'll see what the Delaware batting lineup can do when we return. The Delaware Bats will hopefully continue the trend they have set in the first few innings here as they have seven runs on the board coming in to the bottom of the fifth. EJ Stoltzfus, the left-handed third baseman for the Blue Hens, will lead things off. Takes ball number one from Mark Gunst. The second pitcher the James Madison Dukes have thrown to the mound today.
actually can kind of relate to EJ Stoltz. It's back in my baseball day, which was a very sad day for me. It was. I also bat lefty and throw righty.
There you
go. So ambidextrous here is Stoltzvis, and he grounds that one.
That time he grounds it right up the middle. Just gets by the glove of Mark Gunst and a in-pursuit shortstop Goss for a base knock for the third baseman. And now we will see what Cameron Travellini is able to do. He singled his last time up before scoring a run. And it wouldn't be terrible to get some more base runners on for Chris Brannigan, who had the two-run double last time up.
Yeah, Brannigan was really embraced his DH role today. Had a rocket in the left center field, the double that cleared the bases, scoring two runs. The two base runners that are on right now, actually.
Pickoff attempt, unsuccessful on Stoltzfus. Mark Gunst paying Stoltzfus a lot of attention over there at first base, the third baseman.
That was the first hit Gunst had given up to Stoltzfus.
There's that big loping curveball again from Gunst in there for a ball, two balls and no strikes. One ball and two strikes is the count here on Travellini. Another pickoff attempt on Stoltzfus, unsuccessful.
That was a quick throw there.
That definitely wasn't just a let you know I'm over here, let you know I'm paying attention throw. That was I'm trying to get you out throw. High fly ball into right field. Colby Roberts going back, and will not make the play. That one gets away from Roberts, and now Travellini is digging for third and will reach third on the error by Colby Roberts.
Roberts not having the best day in the field today.
No.
You'll remember in the second inning he came in and dropped that ball. Mm-hmm. And then that going back out into right center field. It was into right field. That was a tough play, but you got to make the catch.
Not even to mention the bloop. What should have been a single from Nick Ferdinand out to right field, Ferdinand stretches into a double because Colby Roberts wasn't able to get over there in time.
Absolutely.
He is one of the best hitters in the CAA, but his defense is costing his team runs here today. And now Chris Brannigan steps in with runners on the corners. Pops that one up into left field. Chad Carroll giving chase. Makes the play. And there will not be a tag attempt from Stoltzfus. So there is out number one as Brannigan is not able to put that one deep enough.
It was the same setup for Brannigan, first and third, but he was not able to capitalize like he did last inning. But Brock Niggerbrugger steps up and is hoping to do what Brannigan could not, and that is get EJ Stoltzfus at least home from third.
Yeah, with one out, still plenty of opportunities to get the runner home from third. Here we go. Brock Niggerbrugger settles in. Takes that one for a strike on the outside corner. Niggerbrugger's body language.
Gunn's still sticking with that.
Did not agree with that call.
Gunn's still sticking with that big looping curve. Mm-hmm.
Here's the pitch. Called strike on the inside corner, so Gunst has painted the outside corner and the inside corner to get ahead. No balls and two strikes against the shortstop, Brock Niggerbrugger.
What if we're going to see a big looping curve here?
Nope. And the ball gets away from San Martin, and that will be a pass ball. Run scores. Delaware Blue Hens go up 8-2.
It's also with a nice heads-up base running play there. I was able to come home. San Martin couldn't locate the pass ball fast enough to get back there and get it to and try to make a play at the plate. So Stoltzfus,
a runner, is still on scoring position as Travellini made his way over to second. So Niggerbrugger still has an RBI opportunity, but will not take advantage of it as he is called out looking strikeout for Mark Gunst.
Niggerbrugger took a quick look back there at the home plate umpire. Didn't 100% agree with that call, but as we've seen in sports, arguing usually doesn't do much.
Yeah. I'm not sure the umpire's ever said, you know what, you're right, go ahead, get back in there, get another chance.
I made a bad call, I'm so sorry.
But now Ty Warrington will see what he can do with a runner on second. Hard hit ball right at shortstop Goss. Goss will make the play, and that will send the Delaware Blue Hens back to the dugout. However, they are able to score for the fourth time out of five innings, getting a run on the pass ball by Gunst.
Yeah, and that time Warrington actually did make contact with that big looping curve, but was not able to hit it hard enough right to the shortstop, Casey Goss, and that will end the inning. And as the crew comes out to sweep the field here, please stay with us on Hens All Access as Chad Kuhl will come back out for the top of the sixth.
Welcome back to Hens All Access as Chad Kuhl tries to continue his dominance of this James Madison Dukes lineup. Has retired the last seven batters he's faced. However, now he will face the statistically best hitter of the James Madison Dukes, Colby Roberts. Here is the pitch. Misses outside ball one.
Roberts hoping that his play in the field does not translate to his play next to the plate. He's made a costly error in this game.
And that one makes contact right at Knickerbocker, the shortstop. Pops up and fires, and that will be out number one for the Delaware Blue Hens.
Roberts almost beat that out, actually. He's booking it.
Knickerbocker took his time, wanted to make sure he made a good throw, and still finds his way to make the out. Maybe a little bit of that frustration from Colby Roberts.
Maybe.
Trying to take it out on the base pass. Has not had the best game in the field or at the plate. His real only contribution to this game for the Dukes has been a sacrifice bunt in the first, so... He was definitely digging hard trying to manufacture a base hit there. And now Chad Carroll, who has had some success, had an RBI sac fly in the first, takes his chances against Chad Kuhl.
And now continuing coverage of the Battle of the Chads. Kuhl did get the best.
It's 1-1. It's 1-1 right now in the Battle of the Chads. There's a fly ball to right field. Ferdinand giving chase. And that will be nothing but a long strike.
That was really well hit. A couple, maybe like 10 yards to the left would have been a home run. What did get over the fence, but as you said, just foul and just a really, really long strike.
Yeah, it was a pretty strike, but it was still a strike. One ball and two strikes. Here's the count. With one out here in the top of the sixth inning. And yet again, Chad Kuhl waiting for the batter to get in the batter's box. Ground ball. Left side of the infield, charging Stoltzfus, cannot make the play as it sneaks under the glove of both Stoltzfus and Knickerbocker.
Stoltzfus was coming in to make the play first and once again misplayed the bounce, and it's scooped and it scooped under his glove, and then that kind of threw off Knickerbocker behind him, and
it has been ruled a base hit, so Chad Carroll gets the lead in the battle of the Chads, going up 2-1 with two singles in his last two at bats. And now Tyler Gregory, the designated hitter for the Dukes, takes his chances against Chad Cool with a runner on first. Cool misses for ball number one, one ball and no strikes. And that was the, prior to that seeing eye single from Chad Carroll, Chad Cool had retired his last eight as a pop fly goes into the outfield. Center fielder Cameron Travellini gets under it and instead allows Nick Ferdinand to make the play coming in from right.
Yeah, that was interesting. Usually the center fielder calls off the right fielder and makes that play, but Ferdinand in right field had a big head of steam coming, and he's just like, hey, you know what, take it.
Yeah, I'm not sure Travellini wanted to get in the way of the big man.
No.
In the way of Nick
and
Ferdinand.
And Ferdinand is a big man.
Coming running a long way from right field. Didn't want to make him run all that way to no avail. Let's him take the out. And now Connor Brown, the second baseman, will have a conversation with his third base coach before facing Chad Cool. A two-out situation with a runner on first. Not sure what they could be talking about. Not many different plays you can have here. Kind of have to let him swing away. Sack bunt isn't really in play here with two outs. Guess he maybe just want to give him a few pointers.
We're discussing plans after the game.
Perhaps.
A lot of good restaurants in downtown Newark they could try.
They want to go hit Main Street before they
absolutely
head back to the hotel.
And you need to make sure that you get your restaurant and your reservations right. So much needed conversation.
And whatever they said, it worked as he lines it to left center field. A diving Travellini cannot make the play. Powell all the way to the fence. Gets it in. There might be a play at third base after one run scores. And there will be. He is out at third base, so one run will score. But the hustle from Tyler Powell out there in left field enables them to get out of the inning with just the one run given.
That was a really pretty relay from Powell, and then ending up with Stolzfus at third. Really nice play. A run does score. Travellini could not make the play originally. Would have been a tough play for any center fielder to make. But Powell with a strong throw into the shortstop. Knickerbocker, and then over to Stolzfus to end the inning. Real nice play there from the Delaware outfield and infield.
Yeah, Travellini did his best trying to get over there and make the play. Laid out, sold out, left it all on the field, was not able to get there. And Tyler Powell doing his duty, backed him up, goes all the way out to the fence at the 365 sign, pops up, makes a great throw to the shortstop, Brock Knickerbocker, who then makes a great relay throw to Stolzfus to get the runner at third. So everyone, a lot of moving pieces, everyone on this Delaware defense doing their part. When we return, we'll see if their offense can do their part here on Hens All Access. And now Mr. Delaware DJ Long will take his chances in the bottom of the sixth. The Sussex Central product started all of the Delaware baseball Blue Hens games, hits a rocket to the third baseman, and goes down on a strong throw from Shabin.
Yeah, it was hard hit, and that might have worked to his disadvantage there. If it was a little slower, he might have been able to beat it out, but it was a hard hit ball over to the third baseman, Bradley Chavin, who made a strong throw over first base for the first out of the inning. So one pitch, one out.
Yep, and now he will face Tyler Powell, who just made a great hustle play out in the field. See if that hustle translates to his work at the plate.
Gunst has really come in and done a nice job for the Dukes. He's given up one run, but that was off it wasn't off a hit. It was off a pass ball. Mm-hmm. So he's pitching well, and he's getting big hitters out like DJ Long.
But now he has to face the meat of this Delaware lineup, as Tyler Powell hits a chopper at first baseman McFarland, and is put away on the cover from Gunst.
And Yezzo steps up to the plate, hoping to maybe fare a little bit better than he did the last time against Gunst, where he grounded out.
To the second baseman. As we brought up so many times before here on Hens All Access, Yezzo is the premier hitter in this conference. And not only that, he is the premier as he pops it up, back, and that will be just out of play. He is the premier athlete at the University of Delaware. At the athletics banquet, he has just received the Male Athlete of the Year award. So congratulations to Jimmy Yezzo, and let's hope he can back that up in his appearance here at the plate.
And much deserved. I mean, what other Delaware athlete has been tops in the country in their respective category? Yezzo was, as we said, he was tops in the nation in batting just a mere week ago. He's now second, but he's a fantastic hitter and great accomplishment for him.
He is accompanied on the women's side by Elena Deladon. So there is always good company at the Delaware Athlete of the Year Awards Banquet, as Yezzo and Deladon both very deservedly received their awards. Although Yezzo finds himself behind in the count, no balls and two strikes. And there is a strike three. He drops it, and Yezzo will force him to throw it over to first base. Yezzo goes down swinging to end the bottom of the sixth inning.
Yeah, Gunst did a real nice job there. Another 1-2-3 inning for him. Came in and settled down, pitched real well, kind of gotten his command back, which he was lacking in that first inning that he came in. And let's hope that since the Delaware bats have cooled off, let's hope the defense can remain hot and cool as well as he trots back out for the top of the seventh. And please make sure you stay with us here on Hens All Access.
Welcome back to Hens All Access. Once again, I'm Tim Donnelly alongside Kyle Coulter. We will bring you coverage of the Delaware men's baseball team's game against the James Madison Dukes for the duration until we find the conclusion. Hopefully a successful one, as the Delaware Blue Hens have already extended their lead to 5 runs, 8 runs to 3. Cool now working against Casey Goss, the shortstop for the Dukes.
There has been a slight changing of the tides, not much, but in this last inning, as JMU is able to cut the lead from 6-5.
Ground ball to the right side of the infield. DJ Long not able to make the play, and Goss will lead off the seventh inning with a base knock. As you mentioned, the tides are turning a little bit. After the first 3 innings where the Blue Hens were able to put up 7 runs, the last 3 have been played even baseball, 1 run each.
And that all coming with a pitching change, mm-hmm. as Mark Gunst came in to relieve the starter, Michael Howerton, who barely got into the third inning, gave up seven runs. But Gunst has settled this Blue Hens offense down, and Cool has continued to remain strong, even though he did give up a long RBI to the Dukes in the last inning.
Yeah, to Connor Brown, who was then caught on third base. And that might be the difference between Howerton and a veteran stud pitcher like Cool. You know, they both had rocky starts in the first inning. Cool able to settle down, and then went four scoreless before giving up the one run last inning. Howerton was not able to ever get control of it again and ended up getting pulled for Mark Gunst. Now with a runner on first, Cool operates quickly. And there is a fair ball. Not many Blue Hen fans agreeing with that, and that will be a double, advancing the runner to third.
Yeah, the first base umpire did not get a good look at that. Was right at his feet. He went to the home plate umpire for the call. Home plate umpire called it emphatically fair.
Yeah.
And coach will come out to talk to the home plate umpire. He does not seem happy.
Yeah, Coach Sherman will now convince the umpires to at least, I guess, think about it. They're going to go out and have a huddle out there on the left side of the infield. Sherman must have convinced him to at least second-guess his original thought. We did say that yelling at the umpire rarely makes him change his call, but maybe we're seeing history here. First time for everything, I guess.
Maybe they're just humoring Coach Sherman.
That probably is more likely the case, that Sherman said it, went out there and argued, said, all right, I'll talk to him about it. Get out there.
But it is a tough scenario, as the first base umpire did not get a good look at it. The ball,
curved.
Where the bounce was, where it would have been fair, a foul was right at his feet. He wasn't able to see it.
Yezzo was also over there in the way a little bit.
And Coach Sherman not finished.
So now Sherman getting into it a little bit with the home plate umpire, wanting to go speak with the right field umpire. This time he joins the field of play a little bit more emphatically than he did the first time.
And a little bit more onto the field than the home plate umpire would like. They're getting into some words. And Coach Sherman is backed up by most of the fans here at Bob Hanna Stadium, who also disagree with the call. It was very close.
In my personal opinion, I thought it was foul.
You thought it was foul?
I thought it was fair.
That's how split this. That's how close it was.
In our expert position from well behind the home plate,
with glass window, netting, and poles in our way,
we disagree. So obviously, Coach Sherman and the umpires disagree as well. And the umpire is telling Sherman to leave, and he is not having it. They are going after it right behind the plate. Now Sherman does get a warning from the home plate umpire. Ty Warrington smiling a little bit right behind the plate. Some of the things his coach was letting the umpire know about.
But there is nothing funny about the situation that Cool is in right now. Second and third with no outs here. He doesn't want to let this game get any closer. We're still in the seventh inning. Still have three innings of baseball to play. Anything could happen.
And we brought up the importance of this game as far as seeding for the CAA tournament earlier. If the Blue Hens do not sweep the James Madison Dukes, they have no shot at getting a first-round bye. Even if they do sweep them, it's still kind of a long shot with the help they need coming from Georgia State against William & Mary. But regardless, they have to take care of business on the field if they want any shot of that bye.
And a big out here against Bobby San Martin would help.
And we know how Cool likes to operate fast. That argument from his coach did take a while, and now Stoltzfus will just make the easy out at first base. One down here in the top of the seventh.
Casey Goss does come around to score, so the lead is now four runs. Blue Hens lead 8-4. So San Martin did his job, grounded to the left side of the infield, allowing Goss to score. But the Blue Hens do record an out. There is a runner on third, so a sack fly is in play as we go around to the top of the order with Johnny Bladel.
And Bladel fouls that one back for strike number one. Runner on third, as we've mentioned. Bradley Chabon, the third baseman, is on third base. That one, grounded foul. This rally was kept alive by a questionable call down the first baseline, whether it was fair or foul. Coach Sherman did not agree. I'm sure Chad Cool did not agree, but now he has to focus and get the runners at the plate out.
The ump is not making any friends here in this stadium. He's getting a lot of "come on, Blues" from the crowd. I'm sure you can probably hear it with our crowd mic out there.
Yeah.
But strike zone, we will admit, has been a little inconsistent today.
Absolutely.
That call down the line, really tough. I think, I don't know if you can make an accurate call either way. But the strike zone, he can control, and he has been a little he's been a little inconsistent.
That outside corner of the plate has kind of gone in and out all game. So, Chad Cool. That time misses just outside. Again, as we bring it up, the inconsistencies of the outside part of the plate, it comes to fruition with what could have been a strike, not seen that way by the umpire, two balls and two strikes.
And Cool has had to deal with this the whole game. At least for JMU, they've had two pitchers that have been able to feel out the strike zone. Cool has just been kind of baffled by the strike zone. He doesn't know where it is right now.
Cool misses high to bring the count to full. That one, no argument. Three balls and two strikes. Big pitch here for the Delaware pitcher, Chad Cool. Fouled out of play by Bladel. Chad Cool, yet again, operating quickly. And the pitch, fouled out of play by Bladel again. Cool finds himself in another long full count battle that he feels he probably should have been out on one of those 1-2, 2-2 pitches that him and the umpire disagreed on a little bit. So that builds to the frustration as well as all these foul balls. Another great pitch fouled off. Bladel absolutely battling with one of the best pitchers in the CAA.
And we've seen this the last time Bladel was up. He fouled out almost at the same exact spots. But we have.
Yeah, very, very similar at bat for Bladel.
Apologize for my stuttering there. There is a bee in the press booth. I repeat, there is a bee in the press booth, which I am not a fan of, and it doesn't seem to be a fan of me. But we'll try to shake that off and continue our duties
as
bringing you the game.
As Bladel works a walk, I will say that I'm proud of my partner for not screaming like a girl. And now, Cool asks for time, wants to kick around some dirt on the mound. First time he's really taken a beat to breathe since he's gotten on the mound.
And that is Johnny Bladel's 50th worked walk of the season. That's 12 more than anyone else on the team. So he does take a lot of pitches.
Fouls a lot of pitches off, as we've seen here today. And there is a line drive to right field that will score a run and advance the runner. Runners at first and second.
Cool, a little frustrated with himself there. He shakes his head, but then remembers he has to jog back and cover the third baseline. But the lead is now 3 runs, and the tides are starting to shift a little more now here at Bob Hanna Stadium. Cool is getting hit pretty hard now. Now he's got runners on first and second with one out.
And I like what Sherman's doing here. He's letting Cool work through it. He's been in almost every situation already through his career here at Delaware. And, you know, giving up a few runs early, not big deal. Giving up a few runs late, not a big deal. Although now Sherman might think it is a big enough deal as he calls timeout and walks to talk to his veteran pitcher a little bit.
Don't see anyone trotting out of the bullpen right now. Just going to talk to him. But there are a couple of arms warming up at the bullpen. None are trotting out in the field right now. Probably going to let Cool try to maybe give him a couple more batters, see if he can settle down and work out of this inning. But we may not see another complete game.
I think they're going to call it a day for Chad Cool. Sherman was just trying to give his bullpen a little bit more time to warm up. So Cool exits the game to a nice round of applause from the crowd here at Bob Hanna Stadium. As soon as we know who is replacing him, we will give that to you.
So over 6 1/3 innings, 8 hits, 5 runs, a nice day from Cool. Not what we're used to seeing, not great, like not a complete game, 2-hitter as we're used to seeing, but still a nice day, and he has his team in the lead. But those two runners on base are his responsibility. They will go to his ERA if he scores. And once we get the pitcher's number, we will give that to you.
And that will be number 33, Jake Clark, the right-handed pitcher for the Delaware Blue Hens, comes to the mound. He will take his warm-up pitches before facing Colby Roberts. So he has a tall task for him and his first batter he will face. Jake Clark, very limited action so far this season. What do you have for me?
He only has 10 appearances, but he has the best ERA on the team. He's got a .79 ERA, record of 1-0. He's only given up one earned run over 11 innings pitched. So he is hasn't pitched a lot, but he is a very solid reliever for this Blue Hens team. And he comes in a little tough situation, first and second, one out. But let's hope that he can replicate what Mark Gunst has done from the Dukes and pitch a few more solid innings for this Blue Hens team.
Yeah, as you mentioned, he hasn't pitched much, but he's pitched well. And that's what's important. You have someone going out there, as you mentioned, an ERA under one. Doesn't matter if you've pitched, you know, 4 innings, 5 innings, or 50 innings, anything under one. If your ERA starts with a 0 point something, you're a good pitcher.
Absolutely.
And that's what Jake Clark is. And he's coming in with a 3-run lead, as Chad Kuhl has set him up with an 8-5 lead. So he has a few runs to wiggle with a little bit, although I'm sure he doesn't want to use any of them. And now he will see Colby Roberts.
Let's hope he can kind of swing the tides back in the Udell's direction.
Putting Mark Gunston kind of swung them towards James Madison. Now we'll hope that putting Jake Clark in can swing it towards the Blue Hens. Clark operating from the stretch. Ground ball to Yezzo. Yezzo catches an awkward bounce and does not get him at first. These umpires will not be the most popular people here in Bob Hanna Stadium. Yezzo thought he had the out there, as did almost everyone else in the stadium, except for the umpire in right field.
So yeah, I think they may want to maybe like give it a jog to their cars as they leave the stadium today, because they will not have a lot of fans. But that was a bang-bang play. It makes it even harder when the runner slides to make an accurate call. But it was very close.
So now,
couldn't really argue either way.
So now with one out, bases are loaded for Jake Clark.
If you're Jake Clark, you got to be a little upset. You get a ground ball to Jimmy Yezzo, who you would hope would make a play. But it was kind of awkward, thought it might go foul. Yezzo wasn't able to field it balanced, so he couldn't get over and make the play. But he's going to look to settle down here and definitely make some good pitches with the bases loaded.
And now he's facing Chad Carroll, another good hitter for these James Madison Dukes, who pops one sky high right at shortstop Mark Niggerberger. That'll be infield fly rule. Batter is out.
And as opposed to a strikeout, that's probably the next best thing you can get is a pop out in the infield. Could not advance the runners. The infield fly rule was called, so it's an out automatically.
And now we will see Tyler Gregory come up to face Jake Clark. Bases loaded and two outs. Now with two outs, it's a completely different situation for Jake Clark. He can just focus on the batter at hand, get him out, get out of the inning.
And it was huge for Clark to get through Colby Roberts and Chad Carroll, who combined have 86 RBIs on the season. So, and now you're coming up against Tyler Gregory, who's not the premier hitter on this team. Mm-hmm. He only has two home runs, 12 RBIs, batting .273. Excuse me. So hopefully he can work out of this inning.
And a pose from an awkward, whoa. Batter tries to say it hit him, and throws his bat to the dugout and starts jogging towards first base. Umpire says, "Hold on, come right back." I've made a few questionable calls. This is not one that I'm gonna give your way. And now the James Madison manager wants to have a conversation with the home plate umpire. And again, these umpires, as you mentioned, might want to give it a nice little pep in their step jog to their cars following this one, because now they're getting both sides of the fans mad at them.
There aren't a lot. There are a decent amount of JMU fans here, not a lot, but now they're probably a little upset because that just took a run off the board for them. But the ump's not the most popular peeper. Not the most popular people at the stadium right now.
And a passed ball. Right. Nobody knows where it is, and the runners will advance, and a run will score on the passed ball.
And Ty Warrington, the catcher, comes up limping, not sure if the ball might have gotten him on the leg, maybe given him a dead leg, or he rolled his ankle coming up, but he's He's a tough kid getting back in there. But a run does score. Both runners advance. The lead is now cut to 2-8-6 Delaware.
Yeah, and that ball popped up off of Ty Warrington's shin guard and down the right, down the first base line, and he just had no awareness of where it was. So it really was an easy run scored. And now we have an intentional walk to load the bases. That intentional walk pitch could have been called a strike. I don't know. I don't know if that bodes well for Jake Clark's command, but that thing was right down the middle.
That was interesting. If Gregory really wanted to, he probably could have teed up on that, but he'll take the base.
And now, with bases loaded, they will face number 2, Connor Brown.
As we mentioned, Connor Brown, the big hitter on this team. 8 home runs, 11 doubles, 41 RBIs. So not exactly the batter you want to face right now if you're Jake Clark, but hopefully he can get his command back and get out of this inning.
Hit an RBI double last time up and then got thrown out trying to stretch that double into a triple on a nice hustle play from Tyler Powell out in left field. So if he does that with 3 runners on, could be dangerous for this Delaware team. Big swing there. 1 ball and 1 strike and 2 down here in the bottom of the 7th inning. Connor Brown. If he reaches base, we will be batting around in this inning for the James Madison Dukes. Not what you want to hear for the Delaware pitching staff. Another big swing from Brown. Another strike for Jake Clark. 1 ball and 2 strikes with 2 down.
Yeah, he's got him on that low outside pitch there. He's got him a couple times. And maybe he'll try to go up and in this time. Maybe get him. Maybe he's gone low. He's pounded pounded it low. Maybe he's going to try to go high now and get him swinging, which would be a huge strikeout to end the inning here and get him out of the inning without letting any more.
Ugly swing from Connor Brown. Strike 3. Jake Clark gets out of the inning, stranding 3 runners on base. So Delaware escapes the 7th, still ahead, 8-6. I'd like to take this time to remind you, for all of your Delaware athletics needs, make sure you tune in to Hens All Access. Coverage of all Delaware sports, as well as a few special surprises from our Hens All Access team. When we return, we will see the Delaware batters get their crack at Mark Gunst. Welcome back to Hens All Access. Tim Donnelly alongside Kyle Coulter as we get started in the bottom of the 7th inning. Coming to the plate for the Blue Hens will be Nick Ferdinand, probably the brightest spot of the Delaware Blue Hens so far today. Hit a 2-run home run in the first inning and a double, which led to a run scored in the 3rd.
Just a few short innings ago, we thought this could be a blowout here at Bob Hanna Stadium, but JMU has clawed their way back off a few nice hits.
As Ferdinand pops it up and right fielder Colby Roberts gets under it for out number 1.
And it brought in this game back to 8-6. As Nick Ferdinand pops out, after the first inning and that big home run and then the double his next at bat, he hasn't really done much. It seems like no Delaware hitter has against Mark Gunst. He's really stifled this potent Delaware offense.
One of the few people that has done something against Mark Gunst is E.J. Stoltzfus, reaching on a single and then scoring a run here as the lone run scored against Gunst in the 5th inning. So Stoltzfus, the third baseman, hopefully trying to replicate his success from his last at-bat. That one, a ground ball at second baseman Connor Brown, casually over to first base for out number two.
Gunt's making quick work of this Delaware lineup. Can't seem to really figure him out.
He's mixing it up well. Has that, as we mentioned, that big loping curveball. And then also mixes in fastballs as he sees fit. Now Cameron Travellini will step into the batter's box. Shows bunt before taking ball number one. And the pitch. Swung on and grounded, fouled on the third baseline by Travellini.
Count quickly 0-2 now.
Mm-hmm. As you mentioned, Gunt's making quick work of this Delaware lineup. Now quickly getting ahead of Travellini here. Travellini has protect the plate and the pitch. Takes a swing at that one. And that will be strike two, I suppose. No balls and two strikes. That ball well outside. The catcher trying to do his best acting job and walk off the field. However, that'll be ball number one, one ball and two strikes. And that is a ground ball to the right side of the infield. Connor Brown is able to get the speedy Travellini at first. So a 1-2-3 inning for Gunst. When we return, we will see if Jake Clark can continue to shut down these James Madison batters. And welcome back to Hens All Access. Jake Clark attempting to kind of stem the tide here as the Delaware Blue Hens have allowed the James Madison Dukes back into this one as the score is now 8 runs for the Blue Hens, 6 runs for the Dukes, and he will face Casey Goss.
Jake Clark came in the previous inning with runners on first and second and one out. He only allowed one run, which was a good job for him, and now he's going to hope to continue that momentum here in the top of the eighth and hopefully stop the bleeding here a little bit. And because Delaware's offense can't seem to get anything going against Gunst, so hopefully he can stifle the Duke's offense here and hold this lead.
He quickly gets behind in the count, 2 balls and no strikes against Casey Goss, the shortstop, who scored in his last time up after singling in the midst of that James Madison rally. 3 balls and no strikes.
Clark, the junior from California, having a little trouble here with his command.
And that one will miss outside for a 4-pitch walk.
Not really what you want if you're Clark to walk the leadoff hitter.
Especially with Bradley Shabin coming up, who doubled his last time up. Shabin comes to the plate with a runner on first.
Goss with 4 stolen bases on the year, so he is a little bit of a threat to steal. Clark, I want to keep an eye on him, but focus on the task at hand, which is number 7, Bradley Shabin.
For the 5th consecutive ball by Clark, ball number 1 to Shabin.
There is one arm going in the bullpen, so if Bradley can't seem to get it together, they do have an arm ready.
Jake Clark settles in, toes the rubber from the stretch. misses low for his sixth consecutive ball, and Warrington has seen just about enough of that and goes out to talk to his pitcher from California. Warrington has done a lot of communication, a lot of pep talks out there on the mound today.
Warrington has definitely worn a path to the pitcher's mound today. He's gone up there a few times with Cool in the first two innings to settle him down, then a couple times here with Clark, not to settle him down. And hey, I think he must be a psychologist or something. His soothing words have settled Cool down. So let's see if he can do it with Clark.
Clark checks the runner first from the stretch, operating. Missing high for his seventh consecutive ball. Not exactly a streak you want to keep going if you're a pitcher. He's probably trying to find the strike zone at this point in time. And Shabin, I'm sure, is saying, I'm not taking this bat off my shoulder until you prove that you can throw a strike. There it is. Strike number one, 3 balls and 1 strike on Shabin.
It's unfortunate that the first strike he throws of the inning is one where the batter is taking, where he knows the batter's taking, so he's got to try to do that more consistently, obviously.
Yeah. Maybe try and throw a strike that the batter can't hit rather than just chooses not to. And there is a line drive into left center field. Both Travellini and Powell giving chase. Travellini comes up with it, fumbles it. And that'll be a stand-up double for Bradley Shabin.
Travellini having a little trouble there in center today. Not so much getting to the ball, but once he gets to it, he can't seem to pick it up cleanly. That's happened a couple times, and it's allowed runners to advance to the next base. And with no outs here in the top of the eight, that's not what you want, especially. And as Coach Sherman comes out to talk to Clark.
I think that might be the end of Clark's day. Not really getting much done here in this inning. We'll see if Sherman decides to leave him in or go further into that blue pen bullpen. And he will.
And number 35, Eric Buckland, trots in from the dugout.
Buckland, another Delaware product, local boy, pitching for his hometown Delaware Blue Hens. Very hard pitcher, very experienced pitcher, another senior playing in his last home series.
Buckland has the most appearances by any Blue Hen pitcher, so he has the most experience. He's got a 4.12 ERA, record of 3-3. He also has 4 saves, so they're bringing the closer in a little early here today.
Trying to get that six out save. I guess a 6-pitch, 6-out save would be the best possible scenario. But
we're going to let Buckland warm up a little bit, and we're going to take a break on Hens All Access. But please stay with us for the exciting conclusion of this Delaware baseball game.
And here we go as we get to see Eric Buckland operate here with nobody out in the second and nobody out in the eighth inning. He is facing Bobby San Martin, the catcher for the James Madison Dukes.
He was just able to do what his predecessor Jake Clark failed to do, and that was throw a strike.
And with runners on second and third, he's going to have to operate pretty well as there's a line drive, Travellini under it, runner tagging. And he will score. That run will be attributed to Jake Clark.
So he comes in and gets an out, but a run does score. And just like that,
It is a one-run
are clinging
run
to
game.
A one-run lead.
I'm sure when you get ahead by four or five runs late in a game, you're not expecting to be in a dogfight when it comes to the end. However, that is where they found themselves with these James Madison Dukes battling back. And that is a ball. Again, umpires being disagreed with by most of the fans here at Bob Hanna Stadium. One ball and no strikes with one out here in the eighth inning. And that one gets a piece of the batter. He will trot to first on a hit-by-pitch.
So it seems like neither Delaware pitcher can really find the strike zone. It has been moving all game, but that one definitely too far inside. It actually clipped the batter. And now it's first and second with one out.
But much like Chad Kuhl, Eric Buckland, an experienced pitcher, you don't have to worry about him as much as you would a young pitcher. So he faces Ty McFarland, the first baseman for the Dukes. And misses for ball number one. And there's a strike from Eric Buckland. One ball and one strike. The big right-hander for the Delaware Blue Hens. And the pitch misses outside for ball number two. Two balls and one strike. And there is a swinging foul ball grounded down the right field line. Two balls and two strikes with one out, two runners on here in the top of the eighth inning. One run has already been scored by the Dukes this inning to close the gap to just one run as the Blue Hens lead 8-7. There is a pop fly into shallow left field. Shortstop Brock Niggerbrugger calling everybody off and making the play.
That was a big out there from Buckland getting the batter to pop out to Niggerbrugger. So now there are two outs with first and second.
Buckland with two outs, now focusing just on the batter, which is a tall task, although he hasn't done much today. Colby Roberts is a fairly good statistical hitter in the CAA.
He's dropped a few points today, but still batting over 400 on the season.
So Buckland has his hands full, hopefully getting out of this inning. Missing low and inside for ball number one. And the pitch. That's in there for a strike to even the count up at one ball and one strike.
It seems like most of the Delaware wounds in the past three innings have been self-inflicted. A couple misplayed balls in the outfields, passed ball at the home plate allowing a few runs to score. So eliminating the errors is going to have to be key in the next couple innings if the Blue Hens want to hold on to this lead.
And that one is in there for a strike, and Eric Buckland gives kind of a mocking head nod to the umpire. Not sure he'll appreciate that if Not sure the umpire will appreciate that if Eric Buckland wants to keep his strike zone a little wider than it is. I'm not sure he should be mocking an umpire after
he'd
the strike.
He'd probably do that if you're still up by six runs. But
there's a ground ball right back to Buckland. Makes the play at first to get out of the inning, and we will enter the bottom of the eighth inning in a one-run game as the Delaware Blue Hens lead the James Madison Dukes 8-7. Stick with us here on Hens All Access. and welcome back to this newly close game between the James Madison Dukes and the Delaware Blue Hens. Once again, we are Hens All Access. I'm Tim Donnelly alongside Kyle Coulter as we get to see the Delaware batting lineup led off by Chris Brannigan take on the James Madison Dukes.
Head 2-4.
Chris Brannigan swings at the first pitch, grounding out to McFarland over at first base.
Yeah, hot shot over to the first baseman, Ty McFarland, who calmly gobbled it up and stepped on first for the first out of the inning.
And now we will see Brock Niggerbroker, the shortstop, try to get the Delaware Blue Hens a few insurance runs as they move into the final inning. And that is a high fly ball into right field, trailing foul, and that will land foul for strike number two. Strike number one, excuse me. Swings at that one and drives it into left field. Left fielder Chad Carroll underneath it to make the play. Two down here in the bottom of the eighth.
Man, the Hens hitting it hard, but they cannot catch a break. Both hard hit balls right at the fielders, the first baseman and the left fielder. Both not really having to move much to make those plays. But hopefully Ty Warrington can hit it hard and put it in a gap to get something going offensively for these Blue Hens.
Mark Gunst is playing absolutely phenomenally. He has retired his last 11 batters faced. And before that, there was an error for someone to reach. So he's done pretty well for himself since coming into this game. And that will be a pop fly into right field. Roberts underneath it and is able to make that play. Had struggled a few times earlier on some pop flies. Another 1-2-3 inning for Gunst, and that will be his 12th consecutive retired batter.
Yeah, Gunst pitching very well, and we are going to go to the top of the ninth where the Blue Hens are hoping to hold on to this one-run lead and close it out for a much-needed victory here against the Dukes of James Madison. Don't go anywhere. We're Hens All Access.
And welcome back as we start the final inning, barring extra innings. We start the final regulation inning between the James Madison Dukes and the Delaware Blue Hens in the first game of a three-game series to close out the 2013 baseball regular season. Eric Buckland is back on the mound, and he will be facing
Chad Carroll,
the left fielder.
Buckland with the most saves on this Delaware team. He is in there to try to close out this game for the Blue Hens, which saw them leading by six. Now the lead is only one, and Buckland pitching well against the cleanup hitter for the Dukes, Chad Carroll.
Chad Carroll is trying to tie this game up in a one swing. Almost left his feet to make that swing. And there you go. Ball outside for ball number one. One ball and two strikes.
He
Here we go. Buckland settling back in, and the pitch. That one fouled back. Count remains 1-2. Buckland with the pitch. Misses outside. 2-2. Count now even with nobody out here in the top of the ninth inning at Bob Hanna Stadium.
Maybe I'm going to do that.
There is a pop fly to right field. Yezo in pursuit. Under it. Gets called off by second baseman DJ Long, who covers a lot of ground to get under that fly ball.
Yezo was not in position to make the play. DJ Long, fortunately, came over, was able to fight the sun, and make a nice running catch to retire the first Dukes batter. They are now down to their last two outs to try to mount, finalize their comeback and maybe.
Very athletic play there from the former high school quarterback, DJ Long. There is a chopper right at Buck, and he will make the play. Eric Buckland on the mound with a fine defensive play. And now it all comes down to Connor Brown. The last out, down to their last three strikes, are the James Madison Dukes facing Eric Buckland, the leading closer for the Delaware Blue Hens.
And if there is anyone who can tie this game in one swing for the Dukes, it is Connor Brown. As we've mentioned numerous times throughout this broadcast, 8 home runs, leads the team. But Buckland will try to make sure that that doesn't happen and try to grab his 5th save of the season.
Buckland misses outside with the first pitch, ball number 1. 1-0. Here we go. As we get down to the final out of this game, Buckland misses outside again. 2-1 with nobody out and nobody on here in the top of the ninth. Buckland with the pitch. That one in there for a strike. 2-1 with 2 down.
That one pretty much dead over the middle, so no controversy there whether it would be a strike or a ball from this home plate.
It seems
umpire.
Like today every call has been protested from one side or the other. That one, not one of them. And there is a swinging strike as Connor Brown could not lay off on the attempted check swing. And now they are down to their final strike. The count is 2-2 with 2 out here in the top of the ninth. The Delaware Blue Hens lead the James Madison Dukes 8-7. Here's the pitch. Misses outside to bring the count full. 3-2, 2 out, down by 1. This has to be the scenario you play out in your mind 100 times for Connor Brown. Full count, 2 outs, but top of the ninth, down 1. And Buckland misses outside to walk Connor Brown. So now it all comes down to Casey Goss representing the go-ahead run coming to the plate. Goss has started slowly, come on strong here towards the end of the game, reaching on a single and scoring, and then reaching on a base on balls. And that time he gets hit by Eric Buckland to put runners on first and second.
Buckland was cruising there for the first two outs, has struggled a little bit here with his command, walking Connor Brown and then hitting Casey Goss. And now the third baseman, Bradley Schaben, will come up to the plate.
So with two outs and two runners on, as we mentioned, Bradley Schaben comes to the plate. Buckland again with two outs, able to focus on just the batter. Get the batter out, get out of this game. That'll be in there for a strike, 1 called. 2-1. The runner in scoring position does represent the tying run, so things are much tighter than we anticipated when the Blue Hens were up 6 earlier today. One ball and one strike. Count evens up. with two outs here in the top of the ninth.
Hey, 3-5, here we go.
Crowd beginning to get behind Eric Buckland on the mound. Buckland gets the signal and the pitch. There's a grounder up the right side of the infield. Yezzo makes the play. Buckland covering. And that will do it. Buckland falls down as he makes the cover at first base. But nonetheless, that is the final out of today's game. The Delaware Blue Hens beat the James Madison Dukes 8-7, keeping their hopes for a first-round bye in the CAA tournament alive.
A very dramatic game. Had to end with a little drama there. Buckland falling as he touched the bag, but he was able to maintain possession of the ball. Possession of the ball. And that will end the game, and the Blue Hens are able to hold on after their furious barrage and a comeback from these JMU Dukes, who are walking out of the dugout a little deflated after that.
When you look at the highlights of the game, the turning points of the game, really most of it has to fall on the first four batters of the Delaware Blue Hens game. In the first inning, they put up four runs. DJ Long, Tyler Powell, Jimmy Yezzo, and Nick Ferdinand, the first four runners of the game. By the time Ferdinand walked off the plate, following his home run, all four of them had scored. You have to congratulate Chad Cool on settling down following his rough first inning and pitching well enough to get the win.
Yeah, and this is the first game of the last three-game series of the regular season. Tomorrow, the game starts at 3, and then on Saturday, the game starts at 1. So make sure to come out to Bob Hanna Stadium to support your Delaware Blue Hens as they try to achieve that first round bye in the CAA tournament by getting that second seed.
For those of you paying attention to the games around the league, make sure we all cheer on the Georgia State baseball team as they play William & Mary, because we do need Georgia State to sweep William & Mary to make that second seed available to us if we sweep James Madison. So all Blue Hens fans are now Georgia State fans. So as you pay attention to the games around the league, keep that in mind. For Kyle Coulter and Tim Donnelly and everyone here at Hens All Access, thanks for tuning in, and we'll see you next time.